Yes. Welcome to another Social Sunday. Fans Q&A. We've had questions from the fans all week. Today we've got Blackburn captain Bradley Johnson, who I know very well. And Bradley, just tell us about yourself and what kind of person you are and just stuff like that.
Yeah, no, man. No, it's good to see you and speak to you again. Thanks for having me on here. About me, well, I'm you know what I'm like. I'm very humble. I'm just a normal person. You know, I'm lucky enough to be in a position that for the last, I don't know how many long I've played, 15, 16 years to live out my dream really and play football professionally. Myself growing up in East London, I've had it hard. I've done it the hard way coming up, but I'm just a normal, regular guy, man, living my dream, still living it now, playing, got a game tomorrow against Bournemouth, but yeah, I'm just a humble guy, you know. I've got a family and myself now, so I said this many times before, you know, for 3-4 hours a day, every day, I'm a professional footballer when I go training, and then after that, I come home, and I'm just a normal guy. I'm a dad to my 3 kids, I'm a husband to my wife, and just a normal guy, man. That's just me.
On that note, let's take it all the way back to your childhood. How was it like growing up in East London?
Yeah, I had a good childhood. I grew up in Hackney, East London, an estate called Nightingale Estate. Obviously, when I grew up, football was, I wanted, as soon as I could walk, my dad said that I was kicking the ball and stuff like that. I grew up in an estate with my mum, my dad, my sister and my brother lived in a flat in Nightingale. And yeah, from when I could walk, my dad always says that I wanted to kick a football. But, you know, I've got an older brother who's 8 years older than me. And growing up, you know, it's like if you have older brothers, you just want to be like them. And at that time, growing up, my older brother was in a motorbike display team called the Imps. So from 3 or 4, you know, going to watch my older brother in the display team, I just wanted to be like him. I wanted to join the team. And I used to love motorbikes. I still do to this day. And I ended up joining the team at 5 years old, the motorbike display team. So everyone says to me, oh, have you played football from young? I didn't start playing football till I was 9, 10 years old. Obviously, I loved football. I played it in my estate whenever I could with my friends on the depths, we used to call them, and in the cage. But growing up from, like you say, them young ages, from 5 to 10, all I was interested in was motorbikes, and I was in that display team. But coming up to like 9 years old, 10 years old, I started taking football serious. And, you know, the motorbike display team and the football sort of started colliding. You know, we were training on a Saturday with the motorbike team. But then the team I joined at the time also were training on a Saturday. So I got to about 9, 9.5, 10, and my dad just said to me, look, you can't do both, choose one, what do you want to do? And that was at 9 years old. And looking back at it now, it was a big decision, because if I chose motorbikes, I would have went into that. But luckily enough for me, I chose football. And you know, it was always something I wanted to do, but the motorbikes were because my older brother was in there. I wanted to be like him. So at 10 years old, I chose to go and play football for a local team. And I went over to a team that you know well, Interwood FC. I started there at 10 years old. And first year, I think I played for them for 2 seasons. And first season, I was a striker, and I was pretty good. I was quick. But our team was good. Our team, we had like myself, Charlie Daniels, Colin Kazim Richards. We all grew up in the same area and we all joined the same team. And our team was really good. Kieran Richardson used to play as well. And within the first 2 years, I got scouted by Arsenal. And growing up in East London, all my family are Arsenal fans. I'm an Arsenal fan. So, you know, when they asked me, do I want to sign, I think it was two years, scholarship forms or something like that, I bit their hand off. You know, it was a dream come true for me at 10 years old, getting asked by Arsenal to sign a 2-year contract. So I done that left my Sunday League team, left Wood, and went to Arsenal. And I was at Arsenal for 5 years, all the way from 10 to 15.
I just want to tap in. Do you know when you was playing, when you was 10 years old? I know you said how like you was influenced by your brother.
Yeah.
Was there anything else that was getting into football? Any other influences?
Yeah, my cousins. I had cousins, older cousins. And one of my cousins, Leon, he was a good footballer. He used to play for a team called Semrab. And he was at Charlton. So when I signed for Arsenal, he was at Charlton at the time. So, where I lived in Nightingale, my cousin lived in Pembury Estate, and it was just literally across Hackney Downs Park. So we always used to meet in Hackney Downs Park, and my uncle, his dad, used to take us in it was the back of the tennis courts in Hackney Downs, and we used to play football for days. And obviously, growing up in the estate, all the kids play football in the park and in the cage, and then going over to Pembury Estate, my cousin with his friends, they were always playing football. And the thing as well, what helped me is that my cousin was older than me, so I was always playing with older kids. And you know what it's like in the States, you have to, if you're playing with older kids, you have to learn quick. You know, you're playing in a cage with older kids. I was small, and you know, that really helped me playing with the older kids. So yeah, my brother weren't really interested in football, but I got the influence from my cousin, my dad, who was a footballer himself, not a very high level, but he played football all his life as well, and my uncle really.
From our generation, because a lot of us were playing with older kids, do you think that's gone out of the game a little bit?
Yeah, I think everything like that has gone out, because you go to the States now, you don't really see kids out playing football. You don't see times have changed. You've always got this social media, and you've got PlayStations, you've got all the computers. We never had that back in the day. You know, it was literally, you used to go to your friend's house, knock on the door, ask them if they're allowed to come out and play, and you'd go out. We used to have bikes, we'd go out on the bikes, everyone would meet in the cage, and you're playing football until your mum or your dad shouts from the window saying, dinner's ready, and then you're going up for dinner and you're asking if you can go out, or you have to come in. On our estate, it was, I think the lamppost used to come on, the lights used to come on about 7 o'clock, and that was my curfew. So as soon as the lamppost come on, I knew I had to go home. So, but yeah, I think times have changed, though. As I just touched on there, you know, kids have got all these computers where they sit inside and they can play with their friends in their own room online, like play multiplayer games or Call of Duty or FIFA, play their friends online. We never had any of that. So our fun was playing out on the streets until whenever we could. So, it has changed. And I think, you know, a lot of, like, as I said there, you go to the estates now and you don't see many kids playing about, you know, by themselves or anything like that. I think times have changed, you know, the world's changed, and, you know, I was lucky enough, and we were lucky enough to grow up in that generation where, you know, where I grew up on the estate, it was very community-based, so everyone knew everyone. Yeah. And, you know, we'd go out on the estate, and as I said there, I'd go to my friend's house, my mum would know where I was. We had no mobile phones, but everyone would know where you were. So, yeah. So now I think
that's mad when changed. You think about it now, you know,
it is. It's crazy. Like I said, now I've got three kids myself, and I wouldn't let them out play on the streets until, you know, when the lamppost come on. But as I said, their time has changed, and you know, it's crazy. Looking back and thinking about it now, what we were allowed to do, and you know, it was a safe environment, but you know, things have changed now, and you know, like, the estates nowadays have got a bad name, but you know, like growing up where I grew up, like I loved every bit of it, and I think it's obviously made me into the person and player I am today.
Yeah, with regarding you joining Arsenal, I know when I joined QPR, I was absolutely gassed, but I'm just thinking how you would have been, the club that you support. How was your emotions at that young age? What was you feeling when you was like about to go there, and Just everything?
Yeah, I was over the moon. As I said there, I'm an Arsenal fan. I still am to this day. All my family were Arsenal fans. To be asked to go to them, and you know, I remember going down there. My first day was, we used to train at Highbury, the old stadium, the JVC Centre. And before training, we'd be in the boxes looking down on the Highbury pitch. You know, and obviously Arsenal were a massive club then, and we'd sometimes be training. You can see the players leaving from the car park. So I remember, I think my first week at the JVC Centre, I'll see like Overmars and Pires, and I was like, wow, these guys are my heroes. Like, and seeing them, and yeah, joining Arsenal, like I was like so happy. A 10-year-old being, as I said, there living out my dream, and at that young age, you do think, oh yeah, this is it, I've made it. But you know, life happens and twists and turns, and it weren't all smooth sailing for me. But the 5 years I was at Arsenal, like, I really enjoyed it.
I just want to like dig into that sort of 5 years. So that 5 years at Arsenal, what was it like in terms of like the training, your lifestyle outside of football, with regarding your friends, and obviously you said you was in Hackney. So how was all of that at a young age?
Yeah, it was at that young age. So when I first joined Arsenal, I was living in Hackney, and then we moved to Leyton. I moved down just down the road on Leybridge Road, and obviously training wise, we were training twice or three times a week. I think it was at the JVC Centre, and then playing on the weekends. But then you know what it's like growing up in like the estates and the community. Everyone knew who I was, and everyone knew Bradley Johnson. He plays for Arsenal, so it was like I was a superstar at 11 years old, 12 years old. Like, everyone knew who. Huh?
Was that pressure though?
Yeah, well, I found that out when I got released, so we'll go on to that. But growing up, being 12, 13, going to primary school, and because I had to change schools when I moved from Hackney to Leyton, I changed school. I went to another primary school. And obviously, going into the primary school, everyone says, oh, that boy plays for Arsenal. So it was like, I'm walking in there and everyone's thinking I'm a superstar. You know, at 12 years old, like 11 years old, oh, he plays for Arsenal. Everyone wanted to play football, and I'm at Arsenal. And there weren't many people in my primary school who like played football at such a high level. So it was good, because I was going into school. Everyone wanted to be your friend. Everyone wants to know. So I had no problems. And then I found out even when I went to secondary school, I remember my first, because when you go to secondary school, they do like induction days, don't you? Maybe the induction days. So my induction day, I went there, and there was obviously kids who were older than me in my primary school went to the same secondary school. So when I went to the secondary school, they were already told their friends, oh, there's Bradley Johnson, he plays for Arsenal. So my first day, they were like, all right, then you can come on the Red with us. Like I went to Kelmscott Secondary School, and there was like a football pitch called the Red. So they was like, oh yeah, you can come on the Red. And obviously they went to see what I was like playing football. And I went there, and it was, obviously I was a year seven. I was playing with year nines, year tens, and running rings around them. And so obviously that brought me attention. Everyone's like, oh, you're so good at football. And then from my first day in secondary school, everyone was like, oh, that's Bradley Johnson. He plays for Arsenal. Like, they not gave me respect, but, and I'm not being big-headed or everyone wanted to be my friend, but I got that, not celebrity status, but I got that sort of like recognition. Like, I got accepted at such a young, like, because it's going into secondary school scary. So my first day going there, I come home and I was buzzing. I was like, Mom, I was playing with the year 10s. I was playing with the year 9s. They all know my name. Like, everyone knew my name. And like, yeah, it was good. But I think then that can sort of hinder you later on, because as I said there, I was there for 5 years. School, my school life, growing up in school, I wasn't really interested in school at all, because I was at Arsenal. And that got to my head a little bit, because every time I was in school, I was like, oh, I'm going to be a footballer. And all the teachers knew I played for Arsenal. They was like, you're not going to make it. You know, you get them to sort of teach. My PE teacher was horrible at that school. He was horrible. He was like, you're not going to make it. You're going to be doing this and doing that. And I was like, no, I'm not. I'm going to be a footballer. You know, any kids like who at academies from a young age, my dream was to play football. And I was at Arsenal and I was like, no, I'm playing football. But so, yeah, I think the school teachers got a bit annoyed with me, because I weren't really concentrating on my schoolwork and stuff, and all I wanted to do was play football. Like, every break time, every lunch time, I was playing football. Every minute I got, I was playing football. I was walking down the corridors with my ball, doing kick-ups and like just playing football. Every minute I got at school, I didn't care about the work. People were like staying behind and doing extra for work. I was going straight out and playing football. And at the time, being at Arsenal, I wasn't allowed to play for the school team. And I think because of that, the PE teachers like resent me even more and stuff like that. And I think it is tough. I've heard you know, Andros Townsend, Troy, his dad speak not so long ago, and he's saying the same thing. You know, when you grow up in schools in East London, not just East London, anywhere, when you grow up in schools and you're at academies, the school can be funny with you. And I found that out, because whenever I got in trouble at school, instead of calling my mum and dad, the school would call Arsenal. So they were trying to punish me, which is rightly so, I was misbehaving. So they were trying to punish me, but punish me with taking away my football. So instead of calling my mum and dad and saying Bradley's been misbehaving, they were calling Arsenal, going straight to Arsenal, and calling Liam Brady, saying Bradley's been misbehaving in school. And then they put me on reports, and then I had to report back to Arsenal how I was behaving in school and how I was doing in lessons, which, you know, looking back now, it was a good thing, because obviously education is key, and Arsenal wanted me to concentrate on my education. But, you know, you tell any young kid who's growing up in secondary school, who's at an academy and they think they've made it already, that they're not going to be, they'll just turn around and say, no, I'm going to be a footballer. I don't care if you do this or do that, I'm going to play football. And I know I shouldn't have been thinking like that, but, you know, I was a kid growing up, as I said, there, living my dream and playing for my boyhood club. So, I found that bit hard in school. I felt everyone was like wanting me to fail. Like my teachers, every time I got in trouble, I said they was calling Arsenal and they wanted to take away what I love doing. So they were, instead of my mum and dad punishing me at home and telling me off or stuff, they wanted Arsenal to punish me and stop me playing football. They knew that that's the only way they could get to me. And it did, it worked. Because when Arsenal pulled me in for a meeting and sat down with my mum and dad and said, look, he needs to behave at school, otherwise he's not going to play for us. And, you know, that did give me a kick up the bum. And I did start behaving at school. But then I got to 14, I think I was in year 9, 14, 15. And it was time where they were giving out scholarships and I didn't get one. So I got released from Arsenal. So then going back to school.
How did you deal with that though?
Yeah, I was heartbroken. I remember the phone call like it was yesterday. I remember sitting in my house, and because it was around the time you knew you was getting a phone call. So like we were all speaking, like my friends, I had my good friend Ryan Smith at the time, we was phoning each other saying, oh, as Roy Massey, the guy was the academy director, was like, has he phoned you yet? He was like, no. So we were all waiting for the calls, and I got the call. And then my dad took the phone call, but he walked out of the room. So he walked out of the room, took the phone call. Obviously, I was trying to listen. And then he come back in the room, and I could just see it on his face. As soon as he walked in the room, I looked at his face and I knew it weren't good news. And I just burst out crying. I was crying for about 3-4 days. I was heartbroken. And then after that, I tried to go at trial at other clubs. I tried to go Charlton and Watford, but they're already given out their YTs, their scholarships, sorry. So they said no. And that hurt me again, going to Charlton and Watford. Like at that time, they were smaller clubs than Arsenal. So I was thinking, oh, I should get a contract there. And it didn't happen. And then again, going back to school, getting released, everyone knew I got released. So it was like I went back to school and I just felt all the teachers were laughing at me like, oh, you got released. You're not going to be this footballer anymore. And like, I was heartbroken. And then
how was it like, sorry to cut you off, but I want to really get into this one. How was it like at home, and was there someone helping you? Because there's a lot of things going on in your life at this point.
Yeah.
Were there any support or anything like that?
Well, yeah, my parents were fully supportive of me, you know, but growing up, my mum and dad were always there for me, supporting me through football, but they were never, like I said, they were never like pushy parents. So my dad just let me always do what I wanted to do. He would never, ever force me to do anything. If I didn't want to go football, he'd say, okay, that's fine. And, you know, it was come to a point where my dad was like, what do you want to do now? And he made a few phone calls, got me the trial at Charlton, then got me the trial at Watford. And then that rejection from both of them, it knocked my confidence even more. And then my dad was like, oh, what do you want to do now? And I was like, I don't want to do nothing. I just want to go back to my Sunday league team. He was like, do you want to go back to your Sunday league team? I was like, yeah, I don't want to go to another professional club, because I was scared of that rejection. So my dad was never, ever pushy. He's always supportive. So whatever I wanted to do, he'd always support me. And he said to me, look, I'm not going to push you or anything, but whatever you do, whatever you choose to do, just give it 100% at whatever you do. And, you know, that's something that I try and implement on my kids now. Like, I'm never going to push them, but whatever they choose to do, I'll always tell them, give it 100% and I'll always support you. So that's what my mum and dad were very supportive of me in that way. As I said, they're 15, my brother moved out, so I didn't have my older brother to speak to. So it was mainly my mum and my dad, really. You know, after I got released, he took me on evenings up training with Charlton for 4 weeks. Then he took me to Watford training. So he was always taking me here, there and everywhere. And then it comes to a point where, as I said there, I was scared of the rejection. And I just chose to not put myself in that situation. I didn't want to go anywhere else. I just wanted to like hibernate and take some time out and try and go back to my Sunday league team. And then he made the phone call to Trevor Bailey and said, can Bradley come back to Innitwood? And he said, yeah. And then, you know, going back to Innitwood, I found that hard as well. Because I remember leaving Innitwood at 10 years old, being the main guy, scoring all his goals and everything. Leaving there at 10, coming back at 15, everyone was expecting me to be the Bradley Johnson I was when I left. But when I went to Arsenal, I started playing like left midfield, left back, centre midfield. Like whereas Sunday league team, I was a striker. And you never, ever play any other position. But when you go to academy, they adapt you like to play all different positions to find your perfect position. So I found myself playing left wing at Arsenal. But then, again, one of the reasons, I didn't say this, one of the reasons why Arsenal said they released me because of my size. I was small and I didn't have a growth spurt until I was about 18, 17. So I went back to my Sunday league team at 15. Yeah, 15, I went back to Innitwood just about a couple months after getting released from Arsenal. Bear in mind, I was still small. So going back to, it's not like academy football where it's all about technical and like passing the ball and receiving the ball. Going back to Innitwood, where it's grassroots, it's just pure physical strength. And I couldn't hack it. So I went back to Innitwood, and the expectation of everyone, even the players, the parents, were like, oh, Bradley's back. They were buzzing. Oh, Bradley's coming back. He's going to score again another 30 goals this season. But I weren't the same player. I come back to Innitwood, and I was weaker than everyone else. I weren't as quick as everyone, because going back to grassroots football, everyone, as I said there, was just strong physical players. Like, they were all strong, quick. And I even found that hard. So, yeah, that sort of knocked my confidence even more, going back to my Sunday league team. And as I said there, and that time at school when I got released from Arsenal, it was only, a couple of months after the next time I got in trouble at school, they had no one to call. They couldn't call Arsenal because I got kicked out of Arsenal. So the school... But it wasn't even a bad thing that I got in trouble for, and they just excluded me. I got kicked out of school at 15. They kicked me out.
What was you in your thought process then? Obviously things are not going well. You're not at Arsenal anymore. You got kicked out of school. What's going on in your head at the minute?
I just felt like I just resented everyone. I just went into a shell, and you know what? I went back where I found not loved, because obviously I was loved at home. I had my mum, my dad growing up, my brother, my sister. But I just felt loved going back to my friends from my estate, and I went back to them, and I just wanted to hang around with my friends. I wasn't interested in football or nothing. Sometimes I didn't even want to go football, and that's just me, because being at Arsenal for 5 years, thinking you're going to make it, and then all of a sudden it just stops. I just fell out. As I said, I was heartbroken. I didn't want the rejection. I found it hard going back to my Sunday league team with not being the Bradley Johnson that I was. And I just felt that comfort with being my friends on the street, on my estate, hanging around with my friends from school. And, you know, that's where I found, not my confidence again, but I just felt I was in my comfort zone being with my friends. Like, there's no pressure. No, they accepted me for being me, not Bradley Johnson, the footballer. They accepted me for being Brad, like growing up with them, knowing. And I just went back there and said, look, like, I'm just going to hang around with my friends now and just enjoy myself. I was still playing football as I said, there for my son Lee team. But, you know, growing up on the estate, you know, you get not distractions, but there was a lot going on the estate. You know, some days when I had training, I'd rather go and hang around with my friends and play football with my friends, or go to the park, go to just hang, like go on bike rides with my friends. I just wanted to do that. And, you know, I not fell in that little trap, but I just found myself hanging around on the street again with my friends. And when I got kicked out of school, that knocked me back as well. And as I said there, I sort of like resented. I didn't want to do nothing. And I was just hanging around with my friends on the streets, like just being with my friends on the estate. But people say, oh, you know, everyone talks about it now, oh, they were gangs and stuff like that. But I was never in a gang. They were just my friends who grew up from the same estate as me. And we were just a group of boys and girls just hanging around on the street. People nowadays would call them gangs, but we were just, you know, kids who grew up on a estate, and we just hung around together. And that's where, you know, from 15 till probably about 16 and a half, 17, I was just hanging around with my friends. I enrolled in a college, done a college course, and just found myself hanging around with my friends, going to college, going home, hanging around with my friends, going to college. And then I got caught up in, you know, obviously the wrong place at the wrong time, really. And at 16, because when you're younger and you're hanging around on estates, you're oblivious to what goes on. So obviously from where I'm from, the estate that I was hanging around from, there was not gang war, but there was like fights between other estates and stuff. And, you know, I think me growing up on that estate and everyone in the area knowing who I was, you know, I got caught up in the wrong place at the wrong time, and I ended up getting rushed and I got stabbed in my leg at 16.
Was that the time when you was at college?
Yeah.
Because yeah. I remember, because we went to the same college, by the way, and I remember you came and everyone was just like, oh, yeah, that's the guy that used to play for Arsenal.
Yeah.
So I'm just looking, because I don't really rate people until I just see the first touch. And I saw your left foot and I was thinking, this guy is crazy. This guy is mad. I think we played maybe one or two games together and I was thinking, wow, this guy is unbelievable. And then that's when you went missing.
Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, I think it was shortly after I got released from Arsenal. I got kicked out of school, and then I enrolled. My dad put me straight into the college course straight away. So I thought, when I was going to college, I still had that little bit of hunger left in me at football. But I think it was in that period when I went to college, I was still going on trial at other clubs, and then I got a few more rejections. And then after that, I thought, you know what, I didn't want to put myself in that situation again to get rejected, because it hurt. I was heartbroken. So, yeah, again, I went missing. And again, that was me falling, not into a trap, but falling back into the comfort zone of being with my friends on the estate and hanging around with my friends from school, getting up to no good. And, I got caught up in stupidness and ended up getting stabbed in my legs. And I think it was because I played football as well, because everyone in the area sort of knew who I was, and it was kids from another estate just around the corner from us who rushed me and I got stabbed in my legs.
So what was next? What was the sort of like, obviously you went into hospital, what was the rehab like? What was your mental state like in that period?
Yeah, it took me, I think I had an operation on my legs the day after, and I think the rehab wise, it took me like 3 months. But I say, I fell back into the estate, but at the same time, I was still half into football. So I was at Waltham Forest at the time and when this happened. But Waltham Forest joined up with, remember, Barking Abbey?
Yeah.
So they joined up with a college course. So from Interwood, they turned into Waltham Forest. And then a guy called Dave Mill done a college course at Barking Abbey. So the kids who were at Waltham Forest, when like they were leaving school at year 11, they went into Barking Abbey College. But I couldn't go to the college because I didn't have no grades. I didn't sit no exams. Because I got kicked out of school in year 9 and year 10, I never sat my GCSEs. I went straight into college, and then I went straight into I went and done an apprenticeship in carpentry at Lewisham College. And so I was doing that. So I couldn't get into Barking Abbey College. And because the boys who were at Warren Forest went straight into Barking Abbey, and they were together every day. They were doing their college course, but they were training every day as well. But Dave Muir at the time said, look, you can't get into the college because you've got no grades. And I was like, fair enough. I'm doing my own college thing now. I'm doing an apprenticeship in carpentry. But he said, I want you to come and train with the boys in the evening on a Tuesday and a Thursday. And, you know, I was doing that when I could be bothered. Some nights I didn't even want to go because I was just hanging around with my friends and didn't want to go football. My dad was like, you got training tonight. I was like, oh, I don't want to go. And he was like, as I said there before, he was never pushy. So he was like, okay, then it's your choice. You can do what you want. And then, so when I wasn't training with the boys at the college, obviously I was doing my own college course, but there were some evenings when on a Thursday evening that the first team were training. And Dave Mills said to me, you can go and train with the first team. So some nights I went and trained with the first team, and the first team manager sort of started to like me. I was doing well in training, and he started involving me in a few squads. And obviously at this time I was still doing that, but being on the estate with my friends. And yeah, that happened. I got stabbed. And then I think about a week after I got stabbed, obviously the club found out. And then Dave Muir and the guy, the manager at the time, Hack, he was good friends with my dad. So he phoned my dad. He was like, what's happening with Bradley? And my dad must have said to him, look, he needs help. He's going down the wrong path. Can you like sort of help? And that was to Dave Muir. And Dave just said to my dad, look, if Bradley's serious about it, once he gets fit, send him back in training and like I'll get his head down and speak to him and stuff. So yeah, it took me about 3 months to get back fit. It took me about a month to get back walking again and then running and getting fit. And then I went back, and then, you know, it was after the stabbing, the stabbing really woke me up. And it was easy for me to, you know, everyone was like, all my friends were like, oh, we're going to retaliate. It was easy for me to go down that route and retaliate and do something with my friends. But the stabbing for me, I didn't take it that way. I took it as a positive. I didn't take it as a negative. You know, you hear a lot of kids now getting stabbed and retaliating, and it just escalates, leads into other. But I was never, as I said before, I would never say I was in a gang. So I was never on the roads, as people would say. I was never involved in anything like that. I was just, they were my friends and they were doing this and doing that, and I was there hanging around. And you know, I just took the stabbing not as a positive, because it's not a nice thing to get stabbed, but it woke me up and it made me realize, look, I'm wasting my talent. I've got a talent. Everyone tells me I've got a talent in football. Like, I'm getting down the wrong path, I'm wasting it. So, you know, I took the stabbing as a positive. I turned it into a positive. You know, I think looking back now, it was the best thing that happened to me. And I know it's horrible to say and think about, but if that didn't happen to me, then I don't know where I would have been today. So I took that as a positive. I've turned it into a positive. I just, after laying there in a hospital bed, seeing my family around and like seeing the disappointment in my mum's face, my dad's face, my nan, my brothers, it sort of woke me up. And then after that, again, I've said this before to kids, because I do a lot of speaking now for the kids who have been released, because I've been in that position. And, you know, when something like that happened to me, it made me realise who my real friends were. You know, being in the hospital for a few days and then coming home and just being in bed for like 2 weeks, I found out who my real friends were. You know, none of my friends who I thought were my friends from the estate would come and see me. So you really find out in bad times, you find out who your real friends are. And that woke me up. And, you know, as I said there, I turned it into a positive. I just said, look, it's probably the best thing that happened to me. You know, I don't want to go down that road. I've got a talent in football, and then when I get back fit, I'm going to give it a good go. So that was my mindset from literally the day I come out of hospital. I had in my mindset, right, this was a wake up call for me now. I've got to take it serious, and I'm going to really put my head down and give it a go at football. So yeah, it took me about 3 months to get back fit. I went back to Woman Forest, trained with Dave, trained with the boys, started playing for the under 18s. And then as I said, there some evenings when the boys weren't training, I was still allowed to go and train with the first team. Then the first team manager sort of liked me, sort of put me back involved in the first team. And I made my debut, I think, when I was 18 for Woolen Forest in the Ryman South or something like that, I think they were in. And then for me, I was, as I said, luck. Football is about luck sometimes. I was playing a game at home in front of 40 people, I think it was. And one of them people was a Cambridge scout. And Dave Muir was called his friend who we knew at Cambridge to come down and have a look at a few of us. And I was lucky enough on that day that I was playing. And I got scouted by Cambridge. They invited me to go down there for a trial. And I went down there for a trial and ended up signing non-contract forms. You know, I went there for 1 week trial. They invited me back for another. And then the coach at the time, Ricky Duncan, said to my dad, look, we can't give him a contract, but we can give him a non-contract, it's called, forms, but we can put him in digs up in Cambridge. So he'll be living out of London. He'll be living with the boys in Cambridge, but we can't give him a wage or anything. We can give you £30 a week expenses for bringing him up, because I stayed in digs from Monday to Saturday and then had to go home Sunday. Then my dad would bring me back up. So they gave him expenses for doing that. I was there on a non-contract, but I was playing at full-time and playing in a league club. So, you know, it was then when it wasn't even about the money for me. It was just about getting out of London. My dad said, look, this is your opportunity. Go and give it your best shot. You know, go to Cambridge, move out of London, leave your friends behind you, and get your head down, work hard, and see where it takes you. And I've done that. I signed until the end of the season for 6 months. I went up to Cambridge. It was hard. I'm not going to lie. It was hard moving out of London and leaving all my friends.
How did you find the games? Because obviously you've jumped leagues, like massive. Yeah.
You know what? I think being in, I say this to all the kids all the time at clubs, when I was in the Premier League with Norwich, I said to the kids there, go out on loan and play. I think the best thing for me was where I was playing and training with the first team at Woolen Forest. When I went to Cambridge, they put me obviously back with the youth team. I didn't sign a professional there. I went with the youth team. So me having that little 2 month period, 3 month period with the first team at Woolen Forest helped me massively when I went to the youth team at Cambridge. Helped me massively. And, you know, I didn't find it easy. It weren't easy. It was hard because obviously the game was a lot quicker. You know, it weren't as physical because obviously I was playing men's football. So Ryman League is tough physically. So it weren't hard for me physically. It was just the speed of the game, technical side of the game, which I learned quick. But I think that window of me playing for 2-3 months, men's football helped me going into a professional club at youth team level. It helped me massively playing men's football. And so I signed for 6 months at Cambridge, moved up there, left London, and got my head down, worked hard, played in the youth team there. And within 3 months then, I got called up to the first team, training with the first team. And then after 4 months, I was involved in a few squads of the first team. And then I remember, I made my debut against Scunthorpe for Cambridge and played my first league game at 18.
Yeah, because I remember at Cambridge, you scored a few goals, man. You scored a few bangers, man. Talk me through, like, obviously, like, your time at Cambridge, because obviously, like, you're out of London. It's because I know when I went Swindon, it was like, it's not far from London, but it just felt like a different country.
So yeah, it was. That transition. I found it hard leaving London. Growing up, as I said, they're always going back to the estate and the community vibe that I grew up in. Everyone knowing everyone. Going to Cambridge, where it was like, it's great, like city living. Like, I was used to being in London, in the estate, growing up, like, in a busy, multicultural area. You know, obviously, in Hackney, and you got your Jamaicans, you got your Indians, you got every sort of race you've got growing up, where when I went to Cambridge, it was predominantly white. So it was tight. And even personally, like growing up in London, moving to Cambridge, going there and living in the house with the boys, and most of the boys were not from London. They were from Cambridge or Newmarket or wherever, all around that area. They'd never seen anyone like me. And it was like, I went there and they were like, why do you talk like that? Or why do you dress like that? It was hard. And obviously I didn't understand the football banter, which I understand now. I've been in the game a long time. I didn't understand that. So they were sort of doing things in the house where, but hiding your stuff and taking stuff, and they call it banter. But where I grew up, I never ever experienced that as a thinking. So I found myself sort of not fighting physically, but always fighting with the boys because I didn't get it. And you know what it's like in football. If you, like the banter-wise thing, if you bite, the more you bite, the more they do it to you. So I found that hard. Growing up, living in the house with 22 lads, it was like the banter, speaking the way I spoke, they always say, oh, you speak like you're from London. I was like, yeah, I'm from London. Like, and then banter-wise, like, you know what it's like. Growing up, if someone said to you at 16 or 13, 14, if someone said to you in school, your mum, you're fighting. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, yeah, but yeah, mum and dad banter and all that in football, it's like it's normal. So when the first time someone said to me, oh yeah, your mum's this in the house, I was like, what? I was like, you just say my mum. And like, I wanted to fight them. And but, you know, I learned quickly to not settle myself because I never changed, but I learned quickly to adapt to it and take it on the chin because I never let them take the mick out of me. But I sort of put my foot down early enough to not let them get away with it as such. But I sort of learnt the sort of lingo, the football banter that sometimes you've got to accept. And I found that hard leaving London, being in a house with 22 kids, no one growing up from where I grew up from. I found that hard. But living wise, it weren't so bad because I went up there and my main focus was just playing football. So we lived in the house. I went training, ate lunch at training, then trained again, double session, come home, and I just stayed in my house, kept myself to myself, stayed in the house. All I was focused on was training. So I was going there, training, going back to the house, resting, sleeping, going training. Weren't a few of the boys, the older boys at the time, could drive, and a few of them were going out and stuff, but I was never interested in that. I just went there to get my head down and give it my last shot at football, and, you know, I went there, got my head down, and broke into the first team within 3 months.
So you've gone from Waltham Forest, 40 people watching you, to how many in Cambridge? How did that feel?
Yeah, it was surreal. I remember the first game. I don't know how many Cambridge held. I think it's like something like 8,000 or 10,000 or something. But yeah, it was great. I remember warming up the fans, and I remember when I come on, I was so nervous, so nervous, man. But again, I sort of got my head down and went there to, that's something I wanted to do. So when I first went there and watched the first team game, I was like blown away. I was like, wow, I want to be playing. So I had that focus in my mind that this is what I want. And when I did get it, I wasn't going to let nerves or anything like put me back, hold me back. Obviously, I was nervous coming on, but as soon as I come on and touch the ball first, got my first touch, I was fine after that.
Because I never knew about this journey, because I just saw you just jumping. I didn't know about this whole journey, innit? So I'm intrigued. That's why I'm asking so many questions. If you don't mind me saying, I was playing at QPR at the time, and I was still watching what you was doing, because obviously I knew you from college.
Yeah.
And I was so interested in your sort of like your journey. And I used to see you as the Frank Lampard of the lower leagues, because your goals, like everything, you're just a goal scoring midfielder. So your goals got you that move to Northampton, wasn't it?
Northampton, yeah. It's so funny you say it, because growing up, obviously he was one of my favourite players, man, Frank Lampard. As I said, I was a midfielder. Like when I was a forward when I was younger, I went to Arsenal as a midfielder. And then when I went to Cambridge, that's when they put me centre midfield. And I felt, growing up, being a young boy, scoring a lot of goals, I love scoring goals. And I felt at as I said, they're 18, I've sort of hit a growth spurt, and then I was more powerful. And then because I was a striker when I was younger, I just loved scoring goals. I was always in the box. So I worked on that. I always looked at like midfielders who score goals, and him and Gerrard obviously were the best two in this country at it. So yeah, it's funny you say that about Lampard and trying to compare. I'm not going to sit here and say, yeah, I was the lower league Frank Lampard, because I was nowhere near it. But I watched a lot of Frank Lampard, and going forward, I was lucky enough to play underneath him, and he was my manager 2 years ago.
So at this moment, you're in Northampton. So do you know how like you've moved from Cambridge? So you've had a massive move from Cambridge, and like you was in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
So now you've earned your place in Northampton. So what's going through your mind, your thought process right now regarding your progress?
Yeah, it was a big step for me going to Northampton, because as you said there, that was my first really move that I felt that I earned, because I did. They didn't pay any money for me or anything, but they signed me, and I signed my first contract I've ever signed at Northampton. I've signed my first professional contract. So when they offered me the contract, it was like a big relief for my family. My family was so happy for me. I was so happy. And it was like being my dad seeing my journey. And my dad was always my dad. I keep on saying about my dad. My dad grounded me in every single way. Never, ever let my feet get off the ground after what happened to me at Arsenal. I think I probably got carried away when I was a kid thinking I was going to make it. So after that, my dad always kept me grounded. And when I signed my first professional contract, I remember going up there with my family, my mum, my dad, and signing it. And then we went for a meal after. And my dad just sat me down. And I'd never forget these words. And he was like, listen, this is where the hard work starts now. All that hard work you've done, yeah, like well done for getting your head down and getting yourself in a position now. But it's nothing now. This is where the hard work starts. You signed your contract, but you've got to kick on now again. And that's my mentality going forward from there. You know, I was happy that I got the pro contract, but in the back of my mind, I thought, this ain't it now. This is where the hard work really starts. And yeah, I remember signing for Northampton, moving up again, moving from Cambridge to Northampton, being out of London. Because at the time when I left Cambridge, before I signed for Northampton, it was out of Southend and Northampton I was going to sign for. And Southend offered me more money in the same years, but then Southend offered me more money, but I'd have to live at home, so I'd have to move back to London. And then Northampton offered me less money, but they offered me a flat to live in Northampton with another player. And again, living in London, I never ever wanted to do that again. So it weren't even, I didn't care about the money or anything. It was just living out of London. So I went to Northampton. I didn't even ring back Southend and say, I'm coming to you or anything. So we just signed for Northampton. And then, yeah, when I signed the contract, it was sort of like the hard work starts now. And that was my mentality going in there. You know, I was still only 18, 19. And going into the first team now, I was 19, 18. And normally when you're 19, 18, you're still a second year scholar or a third year scholar. I went straight into the first team. So it was a big wake up call for me, you know, training with men every single day. It woke me up, and you know, it gave me that determination. And again, the same thought process is, I want to get into this team. And that was my mindset from the go. I worked hard to try and get in the team. It wasn't meant to be. I had to go out on loan for the first year. I'll drop back down to the conference, and I went to Ebbsfleet, Gravesend. I went there for a few months and applied my trade there. Again, playing football in front of, I don't know, Ebbsfleet 200 fans, and just playing men's first team football. You know, it develops from being a young boy, going out and playing first team football. Like, it helps you so much. And so I had to do that for first year. I played a few games for Northampton before that. So I made my debut for Northampton. But I wanted to play because I'd been playing at Cambridge and been used to being in the first team. Then going to Northampton and then sort of having to fight my way back in. Because where I was used to being in the first team, I always wanted that. So I asked to go out on loan. And being, again, involved in first team football, being around men's football and playing, I wanted to play. And that's... I could have easily just sat there and not played and been on the bench every game or playing in the reserves like during the week or anything. But I wanted to play men's football. I wanted to play first team football because there's nothing like it. You can't match it. You'd know yourself. Like reserve team football is nothing like first team football. So I asked to go out on loan. And always in the back of my mind that I'm going to come back and I'm going to cement my place in the first team at Northampton. That was the aim. So I went out on loan for the first year. Went out to Gravesend. And then come back and done a pre-season with Northampton. Again, found it hard to break in the first team. Found myself on the bench a few games. And it wasn't a case of me being arrogant and thinking I should be playing. I never, ever felt I should be playing. You have to earn your right to play. So I wasn't getting in the team. So I, again, asked to go out on loan. So I went out on loan to Stevenage this time. I went there for a month. And then within that space of going to Stevenage, I loved my time at Stevenage. It was a great loan for me. I went there for a month, scored some more goals. And then within that space of time, the manager at Northampton got sacked. So my loan was finishing. So I went back to Northampton. And then I think it was January now, but Stevenage wanted to buy me. Because I'd done so well there within a month, the manager there wanted to buy me. So I went back to Northampton and I was like, look, Stevenage want to buy me. I want to go as first team football. But then they signed a new manager, Stuart Gray, and he come in and he said, look, and Stevenage, I said he wanted to sign me. They were desperate to sign me. I think at the time they were going to break their transfer record to sign me. They were desperate. And Stuart Gray come in, he was like, if a club's so desperate to sign him, like he must be good. Like, let me have a look at him. So I think the chairman at the time at Northampton was willing to accept the bid. Because they got me for nothing. I was only there for a year and a half and they were going to get good money for me. But Stuart Gray come in and he said, look, if a club is so desperate for him, he must be good. Let me have a look at him. So I remember Stuart Gray sitting me down and said to me, look, I know Stevenage want you. I know you want to go there and play first team football, but would you play here? And I was like, listen, Gaffer, I'd play anywhere. I just want to play football. And he was like, okay, then train this week and let me have a look at you. And we'll go from there. So I trained that whole week, come the game day on the Saturday. I remember going in on Friday morning and Stuart Gray pulled me and went, you're playing tomorrow. And I was like, what? He's like, yeah, you're straight in the team. And I was like, okay. So I played Tranmere away it was. I played that game for Northampton. And then after the game, on the Monday morning, he pulled me. He said, you're not going anywhere. I was like, huh? He's like, no, I'm not selling you. You're not going nowhere. And after that, I played every single game for Stuart Gray in Northampton. And that's where I really kicked on.
Do you know what? Regarding that, I just want to know, training-wise, how was you progressing? Like, how was training at that level? Because the reason why I asked that, yeah, is because when you made your next move, yeah, you was unreal. I'm not even joking, yeah. You was unreal, and I'm talking about like midfield sergeant. You was unreal. So I just want to know what tweaked it. Like, where was the turning point? Because you stepped up the gear at that point. Yeah. For me, anyway.
No, for me, training, I sort of had that attitude of train how you play. Like every day for me in training, I gave 100% every single day. I wanted to be the best trainer. I wanted to be the best player there. I wanted to be the best trainer. So, you know, growing up at such a young age, I always go back to my Woolham Forest days, breaking into the first team there at 17 and thinking I was a player and like having a little bit of attitude. That got kicked out of me straight away. You know, I went into first team football and thought, yeah, this is good. I'm good enough to be here. I'm probably better than some of you. But they kicked that out of me straight away. You know, I got bollocked by the first team players there at Woolham Forest. And, you know, that put me in the right stage. You know, I wanted to go there. I knew I had a talent at a young age, but with talent, without work, hard work, you don't get nowhere. So, you know, I always go back to my Woolham Forest days. That was not the turning point, but that was the days that, you know, when I was going into training, I wanted to be the best player. I wanted to prove to these old men that I am better than you and I deserve to be here. And I had to work hard. So I took that with me through Cambridge, worked hard in training, every day in training, I wanted to be the best player. And then again, when you go into first team football and you're training hard, 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 and then you get the reward. Like for me, I didn't get sold at Northampton. Stuart Gray come in and he said, I'm not selling you. You're playing for me. And then I was playing every week, week in, week out. I didn't ever get comfortable because I knew how hard I've worked to get there. And I knew it could be taken away like that. Like I could get released or something could happen to me and it would be finished. So every day I went into training. I wanted to be the best trainer. I worked hard, done my extras. If the club wanted me to do, if the fitness coach wanted me to do extra running, always done it, always done the gym. And yeah, just went into Northampton with that mentality. And you know, when, as I said there, you see the rewards of it. You see I was getting played week in, week out. That drove me on even more because when you're playing week in, week out, it's easy to get comfortable and think, oh, I'm going to play next week, so it don't matter. And when you're playing week in, week out, there's always people who want your shirt. So it's easy to get complacent and get comfortable. But I knew that there was people who were training hard. I see the lads who weren't training, who wasn't playing week in, week out, were doing extras. So I'm thinking, they're doing extra to take my shirt. So I'm going to do more than them. I was always, not in competition with them, but in competition with myself, really. I always wanted to get better. And I just made sure I didn't ever get comfortable and didn't get complacent. And again, going back, that comes from my dad. What he drilled into me, he said, like, you just got to be the best you can be. Be better than, I know it's cliche, but you, I went into every day wanting to be better than I was the day before. So I worked my socks off in training and got the reward from it, really.
Yeah, the reason why I said that, because I know at Northampton, yeah, you was playing good at Northampton. Mm. That's why I wanted to know what was going on, because you then got massive move to Leeds. Even I was like godsmacked. I was thinking, how did this happen? Because Leeds is, it's, although they were at the level they were, but it's massive. It's a massive club, massively. Talk me through that, though.
It was at a time where I was coming to them my last year, my contract at Northampton. And obviously I was playing, as I said, playing week in, week out and getting noticed. I was a goal scoring midfielder, young, playing in League One and doing well. And then obviously started getting interest from other clubs. You know, I went to Leicester, I went to Coventry and spoke to them. They was all in the Championship at the time. And then I went to Leeds and said, yeah, you touched on where they were at the time. They was in League One at the time. But I went there and, like, no disrespect to the clubs where I come from, like Cambridge and Northampton. They were great clubs. But when you go to Leeds, when you drive in the training ground and you see,
I see the facility.
They've got their own training ground, whereas Northampton, we used to get changed at the stadium and drive to the training ground or train next door with the athletics pitch, track around the pitch. Cambridge, we had to get changed at the stadium and then jump on a minibus to the university where our training ground was. When you go to a club and it's got their own training ground, like Leeds training ground is unbelievable. And for me, I was only 19, 20. It was the first, because I never grew up in academy football. You know, when you're young, when you're in academy football, you go to all the training grounds and you play it all. I never had any of that. So Leeds was the first training ground that I ever saw. And I went there and, yeah, I was blown away. And obviously at the time they was in League One, they were doing well. Dennis Wise was the manager, another Londoner. And I just felt loved there. And, you know, when I went to watch them for the first time in League One, there's getting 26, 27,000 fans. It was a no-brainer. And yeah, it was just, again, one of the moves that, you know, people might sit back and think, oh yeah, this is it, I made it now. But it was never the case. I always went there with that attitude again of, well, I've got a big move, but this ain't over yet. I've still got to, again, the hard work starts again.
Having Dennis Wise as a manager, and he was a centre midfielder as well from London. How was that for you? Was it benefit?
Yeah, it was good. He was good when I was signing. He was funny. Like, it was good. He was one of the main reasons why I signed there. But then he left 2 weeks after I signed.
Crazy. Yeah. What were you thinking?
I know. Yeah, but no, I was gutted that he left because I wanted to work with him and, you know, all the boys there. But we had a few Londoners in that league squad. We had Jermaine Bedford, Leon Constantine, we had Trezor Kandel, and they all loved him. Dennis Wise was like the man. They loved him. And then when he left, everyone was heartbroken, not just me. Like, I've just signed there. I'm thinking, well, what's going on? But everyone was heartbroken because he was so good. But he left there, and then like a new manager come in, and it was the same again. It was a case that it weren't for me. Yeah, I got my move, but you know, as again, no disrespect to Northampton, but the levels went up in training, the games levels went up, so that pushed me on even more. Like, you know, I'm getting into training, and I was training with Tore Andre Flo. Do you remember him, the Chelsea striker?
Yeah.
And like, I've never seen, like, obviously I used to watch that guy on Match of the Day playing for Chelsea, and I'm like, wow, I'm training with him now. There was a guy called Alan Thompson from Celtic. Like, there was big players there. Jermaine Beckford, massive player. There was big players there. And I was thinking, wow, this is the level. And I remember my first training session, I was blown away, like, by the pace and like the skill of the players. And I was thinking, I'm just a kid from League One, like, coming here. Although there was in League One, but the quality was just a different level. So yeah, again, that pushed me on to again be the best player there and try and get into the first team there.
I know for a fact, yeah, that because I know it happened to me when I was at QPR, and then the Italian guys came over with all the money just the year before they went into the Premier League.
Yeah.
And I saw some different level cars coming in, and I just knew, oh my gosh, this is mad. I know when you went into that Leeds car park, yeah, it's a totally different cat of fish to Northampton car park, right?
Yeah, crazy. Like, for me, when you're in League One and League Two, grand, like, growing up young lad, you're like, oh, I can't wait to one day hopefully make it and buy myself a Range Rover and everything. Going into Leeds car park, it was like they're sponsored by a Range Rover. There was about 20 Range Rovers, and I'm there rolling up in my 1.2 Corsa. But no, it was just, again, for me, it was just like seeing them things drove me on even more to not want them, because they're all materialistic things. I'm not materialistic at all, but it just drove me on to, it was another level. Like, them things like that drive you on. Like, being in the training ground where they've got their own gym, they've got their own swimming pool, jacuzzi, sauna, their own canteen, where I've never ever experienced that before. Like, having them things there, I appreciate them, and I made sure I use them to the best I can. Like, recovery wise, I was in the pool when I could, jacuzzi, right? I've never ever had that before I went to Leeds, so I appreciated it more. And then again, with my dad in the back of my head, in my ear, saying, listen, it could get taken away from you at any time. So I just got my head down and worked hard.
Do you know, talk me through promotion.
Yeah, crazy.
And that feeling.
Yeah.
Going to the Championship and stuff.
Yeah, like that. It was obviously the best feeling I had in football at that moment in time. Obviously, I've been promoted after that later on in my career, but that day, playing in a sellout crowd at Elland Road, I think there was like 40,000 people there. And the way the game went, you know, we were losing, and then we equalised, and then Beck scored the winning goal in like the 82nd minute. Man, it was crazy. The fans come running on the pitch. Leeds fans were, they're fanatic. They're crazy fans. And they're one of the best. They're the best, probably the best fans I've ever played for. It was unreal, the promotion. And I've got a photo in my house of me getting lifted up by the fans on the pitch with my hand in the air when we're getting promoted. Like, and just talking about it now, it brings back memories and goosebumps and stuff. Yeah, the promotion day was one of the best days of my career thus far, up to that far.
I mean, the journey so far from a couple of hours ago when you was just telling me about going through the struggles and everything like that, and then being promoted, fans lifting you up, playing like in front of X amount of fans, it just shows you that football is hit and miss. You can be somewhere 1 minute, and then you can be nowhere the next minute. It's just, you just have to stay consistent. You can't drop off.
Yeah, you have to. For me, part of it is luck, but I believe in the harder you work, the luckier you get. And you know, I've had to work hard to get to where I am now. I still work hard every day now in training. I want to be the best trainer still now to this day. I'm 34 years old and I'm training with 18-year-olds and I'm thinking I still want to be the best trainer to try and outrun them and stuff. So, you know, it comes with a lot of hard work and sacrifice. But again, as you just said there, I know that, like you said there, football can come and it can be taken away with you within a second. So I've always had that in the back of my mind. That's why I think a lot of people like say I'm so humble. I think I am humble because I know how hard I've worked to get here, and I know that I ain't got anywhere like yet. I've still got to work hard and go into training and want to be the best player. Though, yeah, I've played like 600 and odd games, but I still want to play more. I want to play another 600 games. I know I probably won't, but until my legs tell me I can't run no more, I'm going to be out on that football pitch and playing for as long as I can.
You know, that's one of the things I admire about you, yeah, because I know how it is starting off football young, because me personally, from playing when you're so young, from like literally debut at 17 and then just still playing, it's hard to keep that hunger. It's hard to keep that sort of
And then there's a lot of stuff that goes on in football that not many people know, like the politics-wise, where, you know, a manager might come in and he don't like the way you play or he don't like you as a person. You know, they can just throw you with the kids and make you train there. You know, I've been there in my career. I've had managers who don't like me, but in the end, with the way I work and my attitude, I've won them round. And I've said that to kids before. I said, football is about opinions. And just because one person's opinion might not like you, it don't mean the whole of other people might not like you. Do you know what I mean? So football's about opinions and, you know, some people are going to like you. It's just like life. Some people are going to like you, some people are not. But, you know, no one can ever say that I ain't worked hard for what I've achieved or what I'm still doing now. No one can ever take that away from me, that I didn't work for it, because every day in training I work hard. And, you know, there's managers who... I've never given a manager an excuse to say, you don't work hard in training, because some managers pick their teams off of training. So I'm never going to give a manager an excuse to say, you've not been working hard enough in training, that's why I'm not playing you. I'm going to leave it in their hands to say, I don't like you or you don't fit in my team. It's never going to be, you ain't working hard enough in training or you're not working hard enough in a game. It's always going to be on their call saying that you don't fit my team or I don't think you're good enough. That's all. No one can ever, ever, ever say to me that you're not working hard enough.
Well, I'm going to quick fire some of the questions that the fans have asked. Yeah. So, who's the best player you've played against?
Best player I played against, Yaya Toure.
Mm. Where was that? Where was that?
That was Norwich against Man City. Yeah, in the Prem.
You know what? Again, when you used to play for Norwich, yeah, I swear down, Bradley, yeah, when you used to play against Arsenal, you had a vendetta. I didn't like you when you used to play against Arsenal. You used to put that extra 110%.
Yeah, I would, because, yeah, I remember going back to the Emirates and I used to see all the youth team coaches there who released me. And you see them before game and it's always like you got to prove a point. So, and obviously being all my family at Arsenal, I had all my family there watching me. So, yeah, I had that extra boost of getting released from Arsenal and having all, when I mean all of my family and friends, I mean, when I went to the Emirates, it was like I had to get about 40, 30 tickets every single time. So.
Who's the best teammate?
Best teammate? Ooh. I'd say my best teammate and probably my best friend in football is a guy called Elliot Bennett. I was with him at Norwich. I've known...
He's the right wing.
Yeah, right wing. But I was with him. So I was with him at Norwich. Then we both parted where I went Derby, he went Blackburn. And then I signed for Blackburn and played with him again for 2 years.
Yeah. He had a brother, didn't he?
Yeah, Carl. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Do you have any superstition?
Yeah, I always do my left side before I do my right side. So I always put my left sock on, then my left shin pad, my left boot, and then my right. Always do my left side before my right. Tie my shoelaces. It's crazy. I don't know why.
That is mad. When did that start?
Yeah. I don't know why I started doing that, but I must have done it one game and then had a good game, and I've just kept it doing that then. I know, and it's silly, I don't even remember doing it, but now I just do it naturally. It's not something that I set out to do. It's just natural that I do my left side before. And people always pull me up on it. It's like, why have you got all your left side that on your boots, your shin pads and your sock, but my right foot's bare? I was like, oh, it's just the way I get dressed.
What's your best goal?
Against Arsenal.
I swear, Bradley, now I'm going to go back to it, man. You used to get on my nerves. Against Arsenal, you're my brother and everything, but against Arsenal, I swear, Dan, I was looking, I was watching, I was thinking.
Yeah, no, that's my best goal. I remember it. I'll never forget it, man. FA Cup, Leeds v Arsenal. Yeah, it was one of the best goals that I've scored. But we lost the game, so didn't count.
The thing is, yeah, you scored a lot of goals like that, though.
Yeah.
It was like, who can I say? Do you know, like, Tony Yeboa used to score similar goals? That's what the name is.
Yeah, just screamers, yeah.
Exactly.
There was one season, like you said, when I was at Norwich, I scored 15 goals, and all of them were, like, outside the box screamers. So I've been brought up, if you don't shoot, you don't score. So I'll never, ever stop shooting. You know what? I had a label at Leeds that I always used to shoot, and most of my shots went in row Z, but I didn't care because I knew if I hit one and it went in the top corner, that's what people remember. And it is to this day. People will still remember that Leeds goal against Arsenal.
Yeah, it gets the commentator excited as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
He was getting on my nerves as well, the commentator. What's your favourite food?
Oh, this is a hard one, man. This is hard. I get asked this a lot, man. My wife's Caribbean. I love Caribbean food. I love my oxtail and rice. But then again, growing up in East London, I love my pie and mash, man. So that's a hard one. It's a hard one. Hard. If I had to pick one, I'd probably go Caribbean food.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's the best team you've played for? This is mad, this question, but
oh, I can't pick one.
Yeah, I knew you wouldn't pick one.
But I can't pick one. Leeds.
Can you give us the best town? At least city.
All right, now you're asking me a different question.
Yeah. At least something for this fan.
All right, what the best city I've played for, like living wise.
Yeah.
Leeds.
Yeah, it's a nice area.
But then again, I don't want to forget my other club. So for me, Norwich, I played the best in my career. I've had the best season in my career at Norwich. And obviously playing in the Premier League at Norwich, I'll never forget that. And then Derby, two of my kids have grown up in Derby. I live in Derby now. So I've got strings in every club I play for. You know, I've always seen that, not seen that my country, but I've been at my clubs for over three years. I've played over 100 games for every club I've been at. So it's not like I've been at a club for a season. I've been at clubs for like 3 years, 4 years, and built strong ties with the fans, the people around the club. So every club I go back to, like, I've got a lot of love and respect for every club I played for.
That is mad, because you know what, yeah, to just get over one season at them levels, yeah, do you know how hard it is, because there's so many games.
Yeah. Yeah, so I spent 3 years at Northampton, 4 years at Leeds, 4 years at, 5 years at Norwich, 4 years at Derby, and now I've been at Blackburn for 3 years.
That's good, man. That's good diet.
Yep, good living. That hard food, isn't it?
Let me have a look at this. What's your favourite squad number?
Four.
Why four?
Because that's the number I played with in the Premier League. That's what number I wore in the Premier League. And wore my Premier League debut shirt is a shirt that I'll never, ever... That's always up in my house. Like, that's my favourite shirt my Premier League debut, and it was number four. So my dream was to play in the Premier League, and I was lucky enough to achieve that. And the shirt that I've got, that I played in, I've still got it up in a frame in my house.
This next one is, who's your favourite manager? But I'm going to change it. I'm going to change it to, which manager got the best out of you? I think that's...
Which one manager got the best? Well, again, I go back to my Norwich days where I played the best season I've had in my career, where I scored 15 goals and we got promoted. I got player of the year, I got players player of the year. And that was under Alex Neil. So he got the best out of me. But Paul Lambert was the manager who made me like what I am today. Paul Lambert, playing under Paul Lambert was the best time for me. He was the manager who signed me for Norwich Winners in the Premier League.
Why is that? Is his man management?
He's just man management, yeah. And like the way he got us playing as a team, you know, he got everyone together. No one was ever above their station. Like the team spirit he built was fantastic. And again, playing in the Premier League, I think we finished 12th underneath him in the Premier League for Norwich. I got into the England provisional squad underneath him. And like he was so good for me, like speaking and helping me through like my early stages in my career in the Premier League.
You know what? I didn't talk about that. How was that though, man? How was that getting a call?
God, it was surreal, man. I thought it was a wind up. So when I got the when I got the phone call from the secretary at our club, I got a phone call saying, "Oh, Bradley, you're in the England provisional squad." I thought it was one of the boys winding me up, because we at Norwich there was a good group. I was just touched on there. The team spirit at Norwich was a joke, and Robert Snodgrass was always a prankster caller. And I'd lived with him and I knew he called. So I thought it was him calling me up. And I was like, yeah, yeah, good one. Like, and I hung up. Then they called me back. And it was actually the secretary, Andy. But I thought it was Snoddy. So I kept on hanging up on him. And then he called me back. He's like, Bradley, don't answer. I'm being serious. It's Andy from Norwich City here. And I was like, yeah, go on. He's like, you're in it. And I was like, I don't believe you. Send me like proof. So then he sent me a photo of the letter. And then I went in the next day and then they showed me the official letter from the FA that... Fabio Capello picked me in his provisional squad, but it was getting cut on the Sunday and I didn't make the final cut, but I've still got that letter to, you know, that I can sit here and say I was even thought about playing for England, for my country under Fabio Capello. And then, you know, he didn't pick me for that squad. And he was like, keep on playing well and you'll be involved in the next one. And unfortunately he left, he got the sack after that. So that dream went down the window. But I've got the official FA headed letter framed up in my house and I'm in the provisional England squad.
Yeah, that's massive. And at that period as well, under Capello, yeah, there were some really good players at that time.
I even though I didn't go or anything, like when I got the phone call, I couldn't sleep that night because I'm thinking, oh my God, if I have to go and I'm turning up with players like Lampard and Gerrard and John Terry. Oh, I was shitting myself, but it didn't come to fruition. So it didn't. But yeah, when I got the phone call that night, I couldn't sleep thinking, oh my God, I might have to train with these sort of players.
Just getting the call up, yeah, would just make you think, come on, because those players, that's unreal. They're going for Ballon d'Ors.
Yeah.
They're on the list for Ballon d'Ors.
And there's me, Bradley Johnson from East London. Right. Nah, it's surreal.
Do you know what I mean? I'm not going to keep you because I know you've got a game tomorrow.
Yeah.
Just finally, you know what I'm doing with Wolverine Cross, creating this platform, creating this team, community team. What's your output regarding that as being like a fan, my friend? Being a fan.
Yeah, no, I think, as I said before we was on live, like I said, I think it's great what you're doing because, again, growing up, we didn't have anything like what you're doing. So it can only benefit the kids growing up in our sort of local area. We never had anything like what you're doing. And again, I always go back to my days of playing first team football in front of fans. You never know who you're playing in front of. So, you know, you're giving these kids a platform to perform. And again, like, you're doing stuff like this and it's going to create fans to come and watch. And these kids, these players don't ever know who's going to come and watch. And, you know, one of them could be lucky enough to play for Wollongong Cross and maybe get picked up by a league club. But I think it's great what you're doing. And I'm supportive of it because, you know, local area, and I love what you're doing, trying to help out the local kids, and just keep on going back to, we never had anything like this, and it can only be good for them, and I'm sure they'll appreciate it.
Bradley, you know what? Yeah, you brought back memories. It was
a memory lane, man. Way back.
It was a pleasure speaking to you.
No problem, man.
I hope you carry on playing for another 60 games, like 600 games.
Maybe I'll get a few down at Wollongong Cross when I'm 38, yeah?
I have a number 4 for you, man. Just to let me know.
Hold that, man.
So, good luck for the game tomorrow. Hopefully, we'll see you coming to watch Wollongong Cross soon.
Next
season.
Man.
And, all the best, bro.
All right, man. You too, man. Thanks a lot,
Pete. Yeah, bro.
Take care, bro.